Hi, I'm John Alper, and welcome to the Introduction to Ray Tracing with Radeon Developer Tool Suite. In this video, we'll go over how you can use the Radeon Developer Tool Suite to understand and improve your ray tracing games and applications. We'll also cover our recently released tool, Radeon Raytracing Analyzer, or RRA, in detail. Let's get started.
You can find and download the latest version of Radeon Developer Tool Suite at gpopen.com/tools. Also, please make sure to update to the latest Radeon graphics driver. To start capturing with our tool suite, we will need to launch the Radeon Developer Panel, RDP. Once RDP is running, we can launch our application. RDP will automatically detect the launch and switch over to the Applications tab with our application selected. We can start with the profiling workflow and go over the frame timing to understand the costs of our ray tracing calls. We can profile our app by pressing Capture Profile button or by pressing the choice of our configurable hotkey on the keyboard. Once the capture has been completed, we can open our profiling capture in Radeon GPU Profiler, RGP, by double-clicking on the recently collected profiles list. Once RGP has loaded our profiling trace, we can view the events by simply going to the Events and then Event Timing tab. Here, we can select our ray tracing event and get detailed information about that event. We can also switch over to the Pipeline State tab. In this tab, we can look at the shader binding table as well as the visualization of the ray tracing pipeline and get an understanding of the various time costs. Depending on our budget, this view can guide us on where to focus our attention. For most ray tracing games or applications, we are likely to spend most of our time in either ray traversal or in shader execution stages. If you'd like to learn more about RGP, please refer to our documentation that can be brought up by pressing the Help button. We also have other resources like videos or tutorials that can be found at RGP page at GPOpen. To get a deeper look at the traversal costs and the acceleration structures used in ray tracing, we will need to reconfigure RDP to use the ray tracing workflow. We recommend keeping profiling and ray tracing workflow separate to avoid introducing any overheads to your profiling captures. Simply select the ray tracing workflow in the dropdown on the selected application and switch over to the ray tracing tab. We can now launch the ray tracing application and get ready for a capture. When ready, we can capture a scene by clicking on the Capture Scene button or by hitting the keyboard hotkey of our choice. Once the capture has been completed, we can open our trace in RRA by double-clicking on the recently collected scenes list. When the trace has been loaded, RRA will greet us with the overview panel. Here, we can see all of the top-level acceleration structures, in short, TLASs, that were referenced by the ray tracing calls in our app. This view provides us with size, build, and layout information about our TLASs. You can click on a TLAS of your choice to inspect it. Doing so will navigate us to the TLAS viewer. The viewer allows us to inspect each item and explore the acceleration structure in detail. On the left, we have the tree view. On the center, we have the viewport. And on the right, we have the rendering and camera controls. We'll explore each of these sections, but first, let's go over the camera controls to get comfortable with our scene. RRA has two main camera modes, CAD and FPS. We can get more keybinding information about the selected camera mode by clicking on the keyboard and mouse icon. We can select perspective or orthographic projections through the projection dropdown. Since games and applications may operate within any arbitrary coordinate system, we may need to adjust RRA to match. Here, you can select the up axis or invert the controls vertically and or horizontally. Another, and perhaps more intuitive way of handling this is by pressing the U key as you adjust the camera within the viewport. This will select the closest orientation to the current camera rotation. When RRA opens a scene, it will position the camera to view the scene in its entirety. In some open-world games, this may make it difficult to navigate given the distances, However, we can input the camera position directly into our array by using the comma boxes, or move the camera to the origin by pressing on the reset icon. Now that we are familiar with the camera controls, let's continue to explore our scene. We can click on instances in the viewport, as well as the nodes on the tree view. Doing so will bring up information about the node on the lower left corner of our array. In this instance, no pun intended, we can click on the bottom level acceleration structure, in short, BLAS or BLAS, to inspect it. Just like the TLAS viewer, we can inspect each item within the BLAS viewer. We can click on viewport to select triangles, or we can click on nodes on the tree view. Whenever a leaf node is selected, our array will consequently highlight the selection on the equivalent tabs. In this case, the selected triangle will be highlighted if we switch over to the Triangles tab. We can use the Triangles tab to statistically navigate the current BLAS. For example, we can sort our triangles by their surface area heuristic, SAH. The SAH value indicates the quality of a triangle in the ray tracing paradigm. We can double-click on the triangle to select it in the BLAS viewer. We can then use the F key or the right-click context menu, then focus on selection to focus on the triangle that we have selected. A smaller SAH value indicates that a triangle has a bounding box that has a lot of empty space, which may negatively affect the ray traversal. To get a better look, we can isolate this triangle by right-click and then show selection only. As you can see, this triangle is very thin compared to the bounding box that it occupies. This means that a ray is highly unlikely to hit the triangle while spending extra time during traversal. To get a better understanding of where this triangle is positioned within the acceleration structure, we can use the depth slider under the viewport. By clicking and dragging, we can select the range of depth to visualize. To advance our visualization further, we can color the bounding volume hierarchy, BVH, by its depth. Certain users may find it difficult to see bounding volume lines while exploring their acceleration structures in our array, and may need to adjust the background to suit their needs. To change colors in our array, we can navigate to the Settings panel located at the top right corner, and then select Themes and Colors. Here, we can change the coloring settings for the entirety of our array. For this instance, let's change our background to be a darker color to get a better contrast. In the Settings panel, we can also adjust other settings such as maximum camera movement speed or the decimal precision that is applied throughout our array. Please take your time to explore and adjust your settings. Let's resume our exploration by clicking on the BLAS tab. In addition to the background colors, we can also adjust the coloring gradient that is used in various coloring modes by selecting a different heat map through the heat map dropdown. Now that we are familiar with all the coloring adjustments, we can start expanding our view to see how a bad case triangle fares against its neighboring triangles. We can navigate up the hierarchy by clicking on the parent address on the selected node. Once we reach a common parent on the local hierarchy, we can right-click on the node in the tree view and select Show All under Selection to see all the neighboring triangles. As you can see, this is a very unfortunate scenario, since there are many overlapping volumes in this sub-hierarchy. Our array can emulate rays as if they are traversing on the hardware. So let's take a look at this scenario by activating the traversal counter rendering mode and disabling the axis aligned BVH rendering. We can also disable the wireframe rendering for geometries that have large number of triangles, since the lines may occlude the coloring. We can specify the counter range by adjusting the minimum and maximum handles on the counter range slider. Conversely, we can update the slider minimum and maximum based on the current view by clicking on the wand icon or by pressing C. In some cases, it may be useful to check the continuous update toggle to avoid manual updates. By default, the traversal counter will visualize the loop count of the traversal algorithm, which correlates directly to the amount of time spent traversing. Let's expand our view further by right-click context menu, then show everything. As you can see, the traversal counter is very powerful in finding the most problematic parts of an acceleration structure. Let's go back to the TLAS viewer to go over some coloring modes. One convenient way of doing this is through the Instances tab. Here, we can see all the instances that reference this BLAS. We can double-click on any of these instances to immediately view it in the currently selected TLAS. You can change coloring modes or traversal counters based on the rendering mode using the dropdown just above the viewer. Our array has a total of 22 geometry coloring modes and 8 traversal counters. Hover over the dropdown items to get more information, or refer to our documentation through the Help button. Here is a demo of our coloring modes and traversal counters. Now that we are familiar with the basics of our array, let us go over how you can improve your scenes. When the array hits an instance, it must traverse the entire bottom level acceleration structure until it can switch context and start traversing another. Although some cannot be avoided, minimizing instance overlaps generally helps with traversal time. In this example, you can see added traversal costs when the tree has been split into multiple overlapping BLASs. In coordination with the previous suggestion, we recommend that you avoid splitting BLASs by material. BLASs can contain multiple geometries. A ray tracing pipeline that can handle multiple geometries in a BLAS can accommodate for multiple materials in a single acceleration structure, therefore reduce the instance overlaps. In this example, you can see the geometry indexes on the character to the right. When we turn on the traversal counter, you can observe the traversal count to be lower on the character with multiple geometries. Please note that adding multiple geometries may increase the build or update time of your BLASs. Minimizing the empty volume space in a BLAS will ensure that the array has a higher hit probability and therefore lower traversal costs. For example, splitting your terrain into multiple BLASs while keeping the instance overlaps to a minimum can help lower the traversal cost. In this example, you can see that some of the areas in the viewport have lower traversal hits due to the reduced overlaps when the terrain has been split into multiple volume optimized pieces. The BLASs are built to optimize for the identity matrix and may perform poorly when scaled by an instance transform. In this example, the spring on the left has been scaled on the Y dimension, while the spring on the right uses the identity matrix. We can double confirm this in the BLAS viewer. The scaled version of this BLAS yields worse traversal results compared to its counterpart. A common method to handle shadows in rasterization is to render a triangle with front face culling to optimize the render time. In ray tracing, this may cause the opposite effect, since the ray still has to traverse the acceleration structure, but now has less chance to hit and terminate. In this example, we have the same BLAS referenced by two separate instance nodes. The instance on the left has no instance flags enabled. The instance on the right has the triangle face call disable flag enabled. By using the calling dropdown and then call front face, we can simulate the calling option that can be requested by a ray launch in shader code. As you can see, the instance on the left has significantly higher traversal cost. In this example, we have a geometry with long triangles. Although these geometries look identical, the one on the left has been rotated to be diagonal on the BLAS space, and then rotated again on the TLAS space to match. During traversal, the ray will transform into the BLAS space when it hits an instance in TLAS. And since the BLAS on the left has these long diagonal triangles, the ray will be subjected to test each bounding box and potentially increase traversal cost. Depending on the angle of the ray, the bounding boxes may have a compounding effect during the traversal. As you may have noticed, the BLAS on the right does not suffer from the same issues, since it has been axis aligned in the BLAS space. When a ray traverses this BLAS, it has a high chance of an early termination, since there is much less unoccupied space on the structure. So this is a significant improvement over the BLAS on the left, even though visually they look identical. Given this information, you may have noticed that you can push this idea further by splitting the BLAS. And yes, this may improve the traversal cost, however, we advise strong caution when doing this, since you will be increasing the instance overlap as well as the TLAS build time. If you decide to split BLASs, please validate your results by using the combination of RRA and RGP. That concludes this short introduction video on how to use the Radeon Developer Tool Suite to analyze the performance of your ray tracing applications on AMD GPUs. If you'd like to learn more about best practices, please visit gpuopen.com/performance/#raytracing. We also have an in-depth blog post about the best practices in ray tracing available at the blog section of GPUopen. Thank you for watching.